All right, Bob, and about 93,000 plus are all geared, ready to go. And the teams may have to change, may adjust as we talked earlier. For example, with Mays out, the play selection of Georgia Tech may be different.
Well, if you look at the play selection of Georgia Tech, Jim, look at it. 75% run, 25 passes. You may just want to flip that thing over and see 75% pass and 25 run.
John Dewberry is the quarterback, and as we said, he leads the Atlantic Coast Conference in passing, and a lot will be on his shoulders tonight. Now, conversely, Tony Robinson is out, and what a thrower and runner he is, and Dickey's not much of a runner and hasn't thrown that much, and so Tennessee may have to adjust its play selection thinking.
Well, Tennessee, look at here now, they're 57% run. That's going to change more so in the run department, Jim. That could go up to anywhere from 65 to 75% run and fewer passes. But I wouldn't be surprised to see Dickey throw the ball more.
And that is Keith Davis, who has run for 410 yards. No Tennessee freshman back has ever run for 100 yards in a game before until Keith Davis. And he's done it not once, not twice, but three times. And they'll put a load on him tonight. And I think that Bill Curry's even expecting Tennessee to run the ball at him tonight and challenge that black watch. That's speaking of the rambling wrecks of Georgia Tech. Here they come, 4-2, only one loss in their conference. They really did a job with Auburn last week till Bo Jackson beat them by just 3 points, 17-14. A much different ball club, and here they come, the Volunteers of Tennessee, 3-1-1. They have been in bowl games the last 4 years, but looking for the biggie this year, the Sugar Bowl. Georgia Tech and Tennessee. They kick off in a moment when we come back to Knoxville. What beautiful weather we have in Knoxville. It is clear. Temperature at game time, 72 degrees. The wind, only 5 miles per hour. Little or no chance of rain, and the humidity after a rainy week in Knoxville is very, very low. Bill Curry, six-year Georgia Tech, stumbled at the beginning trying to rebuild them when they were 2-19-1 in their first 2 years, has them on track now. They're 4-2-0 and a very respectable and good football team. And Curry says he's never had more fun in his life. And that goes back in playing on two Super Bowl championship teams with the Packers and with the Baltimore Colts. On the other side of the field, of course, is the man that was brought back to rebuild Tennessee. For a long while, they were wondering down here if Johnny Majors was going to do it, but Johnny Majors has done it. After a slow start, Majors now has his team 3-1-1. And this is the ball club that annihilated Auburn and Bo Jackson 38-20. Georgia Tech will kick off. And that means that Thomas Palmer will do the kicking. Tech has been to the wars this year. It's a big crowd here, but not an intimidating crowd for Georgia Tech squad of this vintage. In other years, with lesser talent, they might have been a little bit intimidated. Pete Panuska goes deep as you see Palmer go back. And he is back there with Grady and Sam as an Olympic sprinter. But it's Panuska who is the lone deep man standing on the one-yard line. Georgia Tech in Tennessee, and this game is underway after a 12-yard run-up by Palmer to kick the ball off. Panuska across the 15, lost the football. It'll be picked up by Georgia Tech. It is Georgia Tech's ball, picked up by Mark White, an inside linebacker, number 35. And there is a big play on the opening kickoff, and Georgia Tech, which kicked off, has the ball.
Jim, I'm not sure if that was number 22 Hills or Pounds that hits him. We'll just see. Here comes, it is Cleve Pounds that hits Panuska, and White picks up the ball, Jim. You can't advance the fumble only if you catch it in the air. The ball is being brought back to about the 15-yard line.
Don Dewberry calling signals, and he'll get a sampling of this crowd tonight. The up man carries the ball. That is Charles Mack starting at fullback. So Dewberry is your quarterback. Charles Mack is starting at fullback. Chuck Easley, 44, is your tailback, so Collier is not in there. Gary Lee is your big play man, number 33, the split end. 81 is Robert Massey. And now we see Malcolm King has come back in. Second down and 7. And here is Dewberry. in trouble, coming back the other way and gets down to the 5-yard line and near a first down. Tackled down there by number 45, Darren Miller.
Darren Miller makes the play, but Dale Jones, number 54, the outside linebacker, watch this here. He goes out there to Dewberry. Dewberry moves back to the inside. You think he quits? This team does not quit on defense. We'll see some great defense tonight. Here comes Jones back in and makes the play. That's super.
Jones and Miller, but it is first down and goal to go at the 5-yard line. Big break for the rambling wreck, the Yellow Jackets of Georgia Tech. They want to pay off if they can. This is Malcolm King and nowhere to go. And again, Darren Miller and Ziegler, the inside linebackers, are there. Robbie Scott, 65. Fred Bennett, 95. Marco Vanek, 59, the front three. Kimbrough, 55. Ziegler, 49. Miller, 45. And the irrepressible Dale Jones, 54, the linebackers. Andre Kramer, number one. Teddy Brown, 14, the corners. Tommy Sims, 16. Charles Davis, 22, are your safety men. And it looked as though we were not going to get all of that in.
Double tight end situation.
Massey and Mannion. Second down from the six as Dewberry lost the yard. This is Dewberry rolling out, throwing, and into the end zone. No good, intended for Robert Massey. And no flag on the play. It'll be third down.
Oh, Jim, Dewberry had Massey wide open in the end zone. They fake, they run a rollout. Gary Lee comes in motion, and watch Dewberry goes out in his rollout, and coming across is Massey, the tight end. And when you see it here, Jim, look, no one near him. He just does not get the ball to him.
Big play here. They'll have to settle for perhaps a field goal. Bill Curry, former All-Pro center. This is his first and only head coaching job. Third down and goal. Dewberry throwing again. The ball is tipped. Tipped, I believe, by Dale Jones, the man who intercepted the ball against Alabama in the backfield and later also picked up a fumble.
Jim, Kimbrough puts a lot of pressure on it, but Dale Jones knocks the ball down. It would have been a touchdown. All they had to do is get it over Dale Jones. Kimbrough is a linebacker coming on the inside. He's putting some heat, but the man that's going to knock the ball down is going to be Dale Jones right in front. You just see his legs. He hits the ball down. It would have been a touchdown.
Palmer from 22 yards out. Ball is set down, and Georgia Tech is on the board as a result of the fumble, but Tennessee held with a first down at the 5. Georgia Tech had to settle for 3 and lead by 3. Thomas Palmer, who kicked the field goal, will kick off again to Pete Panuska. Got a 103-yard return for a score against Maryland and Sun Bowl, but his first kickoff tonight, I guess he's just happy they only got 3 out of it as he fumbled the ball away. And it was picked up by Mark White. So now Palmer to kick off again. Tennessee has not had the ball offensively except briefly when Panuska returned to fumble the ball. It's Panuska again, about 5 yards deep in the end zone, and decides to keep it there. There will be no fumble here. So out comes Darryl Dickey, the man filling in for Tony Robinson, and what big shoes he must fill. But they say he gives them a lot of confidence back there. Very poised young man. Those are his career statistics. William Howard, 35, and Keith Davis, 28, are your running backs. Tim McGee, 88. Eric Swanson, 27, your wide receivers. Jeff Smith, 81, your tight end. David Douglas, Bruce Wilkinson, your tackles. Harry Galbraith and John Bruin, the guards, and Todd Kirk is at center. And here's Dickey. He's the kind of young man that will walk right up and say my name is and introduce himself to you. He is quite a poised young man. You would think Keith Davis, but instead it is Dale Dickey on first down. The throw has a man out here in the open, and that is William Howard. And Howard is put down immediately by Cleve Pounds, number 32. After a gain of 2. Now, the black watch defense, not every member of the defense is on the black watch. You got to be an especially hard hitter. Pat Swilling, 99. Ken Parker, 84. Ivory Lee, 56. Mark Price, 39. The front four. Ted Roof, 93. Mark White, 35. He recovered the fumble. Mark Logan, 36. The backers, Rutland 16 and Travis 8 the corners, and Pounds 32 and Harrison 31 the safeties. Second down and 8 to go, 3-0 Georgia Tech. Dickey hands this time off to Keith Davis, and immediately he is put down by Cleve Pounds, the rover or strong safety, almost at the line of scrimmage.
I was going to say, after that first play, when Dickey goes back to throw the football, Jim, that we wasted 3 days of preparation talking about them going to run the football 75% of the time, and they come out and throw the first down.
Darrell Dickey now faces a third down and six situation from the 24-yard line. Donnie Majors loves a wide-open offense. Question is, can Darrell Dickey continue his part of the quarterback in this wide-open offense? Here's his third and sixth pass coming up. And now he can run, but I don't think he'll make it to the 30-yard line, and flags go down as he goes out shy of the first down. Flags went down behind Dickey.
That's got to be holding.
And while they talk it over, we'll be able to tell you that Astor Sizemore is our referee. The umpire is Clifton Noble. Larry Nichols, the linesman. Line judge is Ernest Benson. Don Shanks, the field judge. Side judge, William Looper. Dick Pace is the back judge. Clock operator is Robert Patrick. So Astor Sizemore is getting the news from those who threw the flags.
I heard it. I could hear the officials down there talking about number 68, Bruce Wilkerson, who was the right tackle, might have been holding. You refuse it, right?
I would.
Yeah, it's fourth down.
Sure. Whoops, he pointed toward.
We got holding on both teams?
Both sides.
Okay.
I'll be. They'll repeat it.
Well, they must have defensive pass holding. All right, well, let's take a look at the man that's going to be called as Bruce Wilkerson, number 68. Now, can we see him? There he is on the right-hand side of the screen. There it is from behind. That's a takedown. That's a tackle.
Oh, we're still at third and six after all of that. 11:20 to go and counting in the first quarter in Knoxville. And it's 3-0 Georgia Tech, first quarter. Dickey. They're coming after him, and across the middle, it's complete to Keith Davis. And Keith Davis is put down, but he is still shy of the 30-yard line. That is Anderson to put him down, the linebacker.
All right, Keith Davis, first of all, he doesn't have enough for the first down. He has to get to the 30. There's Anderson, who is a linebacker, Jim. And look at the play he makes on the great running back. That's super.
And so now Bob Garman will come in to kick the ball away. And Corey Collier not playing tonight. Gary Lee is back there to return punts. And that's not too good a punt. May turn out all right. It's taken by the up man there, number 47, Ricardo Ingram, a defensive back. So 10:29 to go. There's Smokey the Sixth. He is a blue tick coonhound. Back in a moment. Johnny Majors, quite a star, and perhaps the biggest Georgia Tech-Tennessee game ever played when both teams were undefeated. Back in the mid-50s, both went on to bowl games. First down, Georgia Tech from the 40-yard line. Dewberry hands off, and that is Malcolm King, the fullback, who has gone to tailback, as we suspected, Paul, with Charles Mack taking over at fullback. So that means that Jerry Mays, the leading rusher, we knew he would not play. Apparently, the thigh injury to Corey Collier, the backup and the rookie of the year in the Atlantic Coast Conference last year, is not able to play, so they moved Malcolm King over. He played there a bit last year. Second down, 7 from the 43 of Georgia Tech. Dewberry takes one way, throws it another way, and looking to get out of bounds, and does get out of bounds, is Mack. Charles Mack, the junior out of the Decatur, Georgia, knocked out of bounds by Terry Brown out of Macon, Georgia, who is a strong hitter, but he is a cornerback to Tennessee.
You know, Jim, when you call a man that makes the play, Terry Brown makes the tackle, but Brian Kimbrough, number 55, who's the left outside linebacker on that play, he made a super play, got off the blocker and forced the runner to get to the outside and got some help from Brown.
Third down and 3. The Georgia Tech's offense playing against an outstanding Tennessee defense. That is Pearson in motion. And the ball to Malcolm King, and he's not going to make it. He is stacked up. Led by Tommy Sims, the strong safety. And they'll have to kick it away. And this is what we may see throughout the course of the evening, Paul. Good, strong defensive play.
Tommy Sims is the guy that's going to do the job here. Charles Mack is trying to block. Now watch Malcolm King. Sees it, goes back to the outside, and up comes Tommy Sims, number 16, who is the strong safety. He fills the hole. They didn't gain a yard.
He's another man from Georgia going to Tennessee. Andre Kramer is deep for the punt of Mike Snow, who's been punting extremely well. Did so well against Auburn last week. Kramer can let it hit. Going to bound inside the 20-yard line and now inside the 15-yard line. Oh, Georgia Tech is getting the breaks, aren't they, on these kicks tonight? That is outstanding. Down to the 6-yard line. And Tennessee has no field position at all. First quarter, Georgia Tech leads by 3. Only one college stadium on campus in the country bigger than this one. That's up in Michigan, where they have nearly 102,000. We've got better than 93 here tonight. Dickey starting first down at his own 6-yard line. Handing off to William Howard, and Howard does a good job and gets out near the 14-yard line. But it'll be second down and short. Now to sophomore of Lima, Ohio.
I like that. Okay, here we see William Howard. Watch this. He stopped almost in the hole here. But watch him just turn. His legs keep moving. That spin picks up another 5. Leg drive.
Second down, 3 to go. Howard's going to try it again, and boy, is he stuck there and hit hard by Mark Pike, number 39. Whose father used to be a rather good basketball player down at the University of Louisville. He is now a minister, the Reverend Harold Pike, down in Villa Hills, Kentucky. Ball at the 15-yard line, and it is third down and 1 for Tennessee, trailing by 3 here in the first quarter.
I think I give it to Davis.
Charles Wilson, 32, has replaced William Howard, 35. And Davis has got the ball, and Davis has got the first down. Across the 17 to about the 18-yard line. Anderson again in on the tackle, along with Ted Root, number 93, another linebacker.
Jim, good blocking on the outside. Douglas Galbraith, taking a look at the right-hand side of the screen, the left-hand side of the offense. They just do an excellent job. And William Howard, the fullback, gets back in and cuts off the linebacker so you can't get there. And Anderson finally does, but it's a first down.
First down from the 19-yard line. There's Davis, steps past the line of scrimmage and doesn't get much more, does he? That's a fine play there. Made by number 10, 93, Ted Roof. He is a member of the Black Watch defense, and the other members have voted him the hardest hitter on the team, number 93.
Jim, that time of Keith Davis, well, all right, here they are, the Black Watch. Go ahead.
Sweating, great pass rusher. Roof, who just made the tackle. Anderson has been on some. Sandrobri, he has been out hurt. Steve Clee Pounds has been on some. Hogan and Ricardo Ingram. Now, to get on the Black Watch, you got to be voted on by those folks. Second down and long. Second and 9 to go. And Keith Davis does not get anywhere near the 9. Submarine down the bottom is Ted Roof. Or I should say Jim Anderson along with Ted Roof. And so that'll be third down and long. Put the ball at the 21-yard line.
Jim, it just looks like Georgia Tech, they're taking their defense, reading the formations, and they're overshifting their defense and trying to force Tennessee to run where they want them to run, which is back weak, and they're getting a great pursuit from their linebackers.
Third down and 7 to go. Howard checks back in at the fullback spot for Tennessee. Dickey's going to give the ball to Keith Davis, and Davis does not get the first down, and there's Ted Roof again, along with Anderson. Anderson, 91, Roof, 93.
Ted Roof is just a super linebacker. I mean, in this job, he's playing the middle inside linebacker, and he is the man that's going to end up making the play. Watch when you see number 93 just at the feet of Davis. Bang, down they go. Along with Anderson, you're right.
Garman to kick the ball away, and Gary Lee is the man deep. And Lee is going to try to return this from the 31-yard line and gets to about the 35-yard line. 5:25 to go. First quarter, Georgia Tech 3, Tennessee nothing. And Georgia Tech has never been without good field position. They've got it a gun near their own 35-yard line. For Tennessee, Robbie Scott has moved over to the right defensive tackle. And Richard Cooper, the tallest man on the squad, he's got 3 sacks already. Number 77 is playing the left tackle spot. He is a pass rusher. They might be expecting Dewberry trying to move the ball through the air. Easley 44, Kelsey 1 are your setbacks. They have really gone down the line in the Georgia Tech lineup. And here's Kelsey just in the ball game. And Kelsey is submarined by not one, but 2 men. Getting up, you can see, is Teddy Brown. And the other looked to be Robbie Scott. Gain of a couple of yards, 2nd down and 8.
Scott and Brown coming up. Terry Brown, number 14. They're just going to fill the gap here on Kelsey. Right here, there's just no place to go. And that man on the bottom was Terry Brown.
4:55 to go in this, the first quarter. Both wideouts, wide receivers are to the right, and now in motion comes Pearson. Dewberry being chased and gets the ball away to his tight end Massey. And Massey's got the first down and has moved into Tennessee territory. You saw Cooper pursuing Dewberry, and he got the ball away to Massey. First down, Georgia Tech.
He was in Dewberry's space, Jim. You're talking about the man that had 3 sacks last week. Here he comes, or this year so far. And Dewberry tries to just a bootleg out by himself. There's no one to block. And then when Cooper goes down on you, that's got to hurt. But they did pick up the first down to the tight end.
More substitutions in that backfield for Georgia Tech. They're using a lot of folks back there. First down from the 49-yard line. Ball is handed off, and that is Malcolm King, who is back in the ball game, playing tailback, and Larry or Kelly Ziegler put him down. After a gain of about 3 down to the 46.5-yard line, let's call it 2nd down and 7.
Jim, the blocking, this is Toby Pearson that's coming out to the outside. Now watch, his job is to cut down Jones, and that's what he does. He hits him right at the knees. He got some help. That's just an excellent block.
Oh, my heavens, come back. That is Manning, who just came in the game. He is 8 yards downfield. Nobody else moved except for Tim Manion. Talk about eager or missing the snap count. One of the two. That'll cost them 5. It'll be 2nd down and 12.
Tim Manion, it just looked like Manion figured they're going to go on the first sound. And as soon as they said set or whatever their first call is, he was gone.
And he's gone now because Massey is coming back in. But many times they run those tight ends in with plays. They move it back 5 yards. Havanek has come back in, and Scott has gone out. So you're
on the offense, on tech.
On the outside of your front three, you've got Havanek and Cooper. For Tennessee, 3-0 Georgia Tech, 2nd down and 12. Dewberry, the short drop. This is running play all the way, but not for much, is it? Fine play there by number 98, Richard Brown, the senior out of Riviera Beach, Florida. Plays a middle guard spot.
Dewberry, quarterback draw all the way. You watch, he'll take 2 or 3 steps back, and then all of a sudden he comes up, but Brown was not fooled. No one blocked him. He's in the backfield, and he knows it. That's not a quarterback sack.
Easley has checked back in, number 44, one of the running backs, but he is flanked to the left. There are 2 other wide receivers to the right on 3rd down and 15. Now that is Easley in motion. Dewberry rolling out. Better throw it. Does throw it, and has Manion, the man who went offside. He's got the first down at the 25. Dewberry showed poise. Manion came back in. First down, Georgia Tech.
Jim, if anybody ever questioned Dewberry's arm, not on that play. He's running to his right. He throws back to his left between 3 defenders and hits Manion. Watch this. Now he goes outside. Cooper is chasing him again. He gets by Cooper. Now he gets up, gets his body square. Now watch, he's throwing back across the field. There are 3 defenders right in that position. Terry Brown was the closest to Manion, but they pick up the first down at the 25.
Georgia Tech leading by 3 and on the move. Drive start their own 35-yard line. Easley carries the ball, and there is nothing there at all. That is Mark Havanek, the sophomore out of Yorktown, Virginia, number 59, who has 5 sacks this year, 3 of those sacks against Florida. Ball at the 25-yard line. Second down and 10. 2:09 to go, first quarter.
I don't think to see Georgia Tech try to run up through the middle much longer because there's nothing there. It's jammed up. You've got to go either wide or throw.
Pearson in motion. Dewberry still has the ball. Dewberry throws and overthrows his intended receiver, Charles Mack, coming out of the backfield. It is third down and 10. Big crowd, big night for both Georgia Tech and Tennessee. Florida not eligible for the Sugar Bowl. Tennessee's only got one loss in the Southeastern Conference. And in the Atlantic Coast Conference, Georgia Tech has lost one. Maryland is the only team that has lost none in conference play. And there's some of the portion of more than 93,000 expected to be here. Malcolm King and Nate Kelsey against five defensive backs for Tennessee on third and 10. King, the man in motion. Dewberry, look out. Going to run. Slips one tackle, does not get it, but they're in field goal range, I do believe, as Kelly Ziegler put him down inside the 20-yard line.
This is when you think knee injuries, Jim, when you see what happens to Dewberry. He's going to shake Cooper, number 77. You see Cooper on the top of your screen. Now watch. When Dewberry goes down, here comes Cooper. And the big man gets his arms around. Dewberry strong enough to get through. But now watch what happened right at the knees. And when you get hit there, that's what happened to Robinson. But his leg was planted. That time, Dewberry's leg was off the ground.
Georgia Tech has called timeout. A top 20 today. Iowa buried Northwestern 49-10. Indiana stayed with Michigan for a while. And Michigan ran away from a 15-0 tie to win 42-15. Penn State shut out West Virginia 27-0. Joe Paterno's group is on its way. Florida rolled over Virginia Tech. Nebraska struggled with Colorado, but won by 10. The Air Force won its eighth in a row, this time over Utah. Auburn, with Bo Jackson getting 160-plus yards, beat Mississippi State 21-9. Minnesota struggled with Ohio State, or I should say the other way around, the Buckeyes finally winning by 4. Oklahoma bowled over Iowa State, a team that scared the dickens out of them last year. Florida State got an interception on the last play of the game. That made it a 10-point difference over North Carolina. Oklahoma State beat Kansas. Arkansas rolled over Houston. And here comes Thomas Palmer. This one will be 35 yards. He's already got one of 22. From 35 yards out, if it makes it, it just will and does not. 35-yard kick, but there's a flag down on the play.
No, that's just part of a jersey, Jim. It looked like a flag, but it was part of an orange shirt.
Well, let's see what happened to Palmer.
Palmer just does not get it. He looks like he got underneath the ball and then pushed it to the right. He really got underneath because the ball looked like it never had a chance to get there. He does some acting. Referee didn't want to buy it. Here it comes. Now watch. Underneath the ball, coming into the side. He really didn't get hit. He landed on top of his toe. That's all. That's the flag we thought was a flag, Jim. It was a yellow or an orange towel.
Well, here comes Tennessee. They haven't gone downfield yet. Howard and Davis the setbacks, and Darrell Dickey in for Tony Robinson, leading the offense. That is Tim McGee checking in for the snap count. Give the ball to Keith Davis, and Davis barrels out to about the 25-yard line. We were giving you the top 20 scores, got through the top 15. Baylor could be going to the Sugar Bowl, huh? Beat TCU 45-0. Oh, Jim Wacker's group is having a tough year. SMU roll over Texas, the most points ever scored against Texas by SMU. And Stanford, surprise, upset Arizona, which could win and still may win the Pac-10. But Stanford surprised them today, winning by 11. Second down and 5 to go in this 3-0 ball game. Georgia Tech leading in the first quarter, less than a minute to go in the quarter. Davis again, and not much there. Well, they're playing the runner, Keith Davis, very well. That time, it was Ralph Malone, number 95, a defensive end, that made the stop.
There's one guy I've seen around, at least around the ball, got a piece of the tackle on almost every single running play, and that's Ted Roof, number 93, the inside linebacker.
They say he has been voted the hardest hitter on the team, and some say he may be one of the hardest hitters, if not, and remember all those other good linebackers and linemen in the Southeastern Conference, may be the hardest. Panuska has come in. He is the tailback, and Wilson is the upback, and Dickey is back to throw and throws out of here. The ball is batted down at the line of scrimmage by Malone, who just made the tackle earlier. Johnny Majors knew he was in for a tough night, and with 1 second to go in the quarter, he knows he is in the middle of a tough night.
Well, we have Malone on the one side, and knocks it down, and we're going to see Swilling, number 99. He's trying to get in there. He ran over his own man.
Bob Garman is the kicker, and Gary Lee is deep. Garman and Lee will have a good chance for a return here. But look out. Down he goes in a hurry, and that looked like Ziegler, the inside linebacker that got down there. End of the quarter, 3-0 Georgia Tech. Jim Simpson, Paul McGuire. We begin the second quarter here in Knoxville, Tennessee. Georgia Tech with the ball first and 10 at their own 44, leading by 3. And the sixth offensive back is in there for Georgia Tech. That is Carter, but that is not Carter carrying the football. Carter is the up man. With Collier and Mays gone, they have used 6, and Malcolm King is now running out of the tailback spot as he has been instead of the fullback spot as he normally does.
Now we saw Massey catching the ball, Jim. Let's just take a look at him blocking. He gets through the linebacker, and that's what he's supposed to do. Dale Jones hit him first, but when he does that, he has to go through to the inside middle linebacker, which he does all right there, too.
Charles Mack comes in. So we've had King, Easley, King, Mack, Kelsey, and Carter all together. And they keep shuffling them in and out. Right now, there's Mack and King. And that is Mack with the football, looking for somewhere to go. And not much. Gets across the 50-yard line. Moves into Georgia or Tennessee territory, where it is third down and short. DeLong made the stop.
Not surprising. Georgia Tech, they're up by 3. They've got 70. But what's nice about it, take a look. We knew that they were going to pass more, which they're doing. They get more yards passing. We knew that Tennessee, they were going to run more. Tennessee, 7 yards passing, and that's really no surprise.
All on the 48-yard line of Tennessee. And it is third down and a long 2 to go. Second man through is King. He's got the first down and across the 40 to about the 39-yard line. And Georgia Tech begins to move that football again against Tennessee.
You know, this is a good lead block now by Mack. Take a look at Charles Mack, number 27. He takes the fake, and then he just pushes into the line. They're moving Cooper, number 77, back. The one man that got a great block was Massey, number 81, the tight end, on Dale Jones, number 54, the great linebacker.
Richard Hills, a new wide receiver, is a freshman of Lakeland, Florida, has not caught a ball yet, is wide to the left. His number's 22. On first down, though, they're going to run the ball, and this is Malcolm King. And boy, did he get crunched from behind and from up front. DeLong hit him from up front and Bennett from behind. Keith DeLong, we've mentioned him several times, Paul, and you know his dad, Steve, who's an Outland Trophy winner here, as well as an All-American.
Steve DeLong at San Diego Chargers. Excellent football player.
Second down and 10 to go. Now, there is Smokey the Six. Let me get this right. He is a blue tick coonhound. And owned as he is by the Reverend W.C. Brooks. And they go pick him up every game time and take Smokey the Six. He's been raising for years. Here's Dewberry. The ball is knocked down, but it is caught. How about that? It was tipped by one of the Tennessee men and yet caught by Malcolm King for a pickup of about 7 yards. It'll be third down and a couple.
That's when things happen, Jim. The ball is tipped. Dale Jones is a linebacker. He isn't the one that tips it, I don't think. But just sit right here, Dewberry goes back. And when things start to go right, they go right. There the ball is tipped. That's by Bobby Scott, Robbie Scott, number 65. But it goes into the hands of King, and they pick up yardage.
Third down. Let's call it 3 yards to go from a 33 of Tennessee. Georgia Tech leading by 3. And the ball is up for grabs, and Tennessee's got it, I do believe. Bad snap from center on the exchange. Darren Miller jumps on the ball, and there's the turnover that Tennessee needs. And they take over at their own 33-yard line.
Dewberry never got the ball from Hearn, the center, number 50. And watch it. This ball's going to shoot straight up in the air, and it goes up his back. I don't know what the connection was, unless he pulled out a little bit too soon. Went off Hearn's helmet, right into the arms of Miller.
All right, 11:57 to go. Second quarter, 3-0. The Rambling Wreck. First down. Tennessee on their own 34-yard line after recovering the fumble. Jeff Smith sets up on the other side, the tight end. Dickey, and this is Keith Davis, and Davis is ridden down on a fine play by Doug Sendenbridge. Senderbury has not played because of a knee recently. He was out of the Auburn game, but the junior out of North Salt Lake City, Utah, made that tackle. Number 89. It is second down and six to go. Ball on the 38-yard line. Well, Tim McGee hasn't been thrown to yet. He's their leading pass catcher, an All-American. Eric Swanson is playing tonight. They haven't thrown to him either. And here's Dickey setting up on this side to Pearson, and that doesn't work for much. Knocked down immediately out there.
To McGee.
I said Pearson. It is McGee. I'm sorry. Senior out of Cleveland, Ohio. And Mark Hogan put him down. Pearson, of course, is 88 for Georgia Tech. McGee, 88 for Tennessee. And out is third down, and nearly five to go. Corey Hale is in. He goes wide to the right, wide receiver. You would think pass, but with Keith Davis back there, you don't know. In any event, it seems as though Darryl Dickey is checking off at the line of scrimmage. Keith Davis does have it, and Davis is not going to get the first down. The first hit was made there by number 99, Pat Swilling. And he is their best defensive down lineman. He is a four-year starter. And it's fourth down Tennessee, and a Tennessee man is still down.
Just take a look at the penetration by Swilling, Jimmy. Gets into the backfield. He is there. Excuse me, that's Ndobri, I think, is the man that was in there, number 89, instead of 99.
All right, let's give it to Doug Ndobri and say that's the second big play he has made in this series. Timeout. We'll come back to Knoxville. There is Buzz, the Yellow Jacket. And when they first started getting mascot down there called a Yellow Jacket, not because of bumblebees or Yellow Jackets or wasps, but rather way back at the turn of the century, when you go to a Georgia Tech football game, most would wear yellow jackets and yellow trousers. That's where the Yellow Jacket came from. Fourth down, and they're going to have to punt the ball away. Bob Garman to kick the ball away, and Gary Lee calling for a fair catch inside the 20 at the 19-yard line, and it will be first down Georgia Tech. And they have begun to dominate this ball game a little bit. They've had the good field position and have done very well.
All right, Jim, this is after the first quarter now, okay? For the season, 75 run, 25. We talked about at the beginning of the show. Now, look, at 62 run for Georgia Tech, 38 pass. We thought that that would be different, but we knew that this would change. They're running for Tennessee, 81% running, only 19% passing. That's through the first quarter.
And there is the injured player for Tennessee, the senior David Douglas, out of Spring City. And they're working down in the vicinity of that knee. John Dewberry, his team leads by three, 10 minutes to go, third quarter. And there, carrying for the first time, is Chuck Easley. And Easley does a good job and may have the first down near the 30-yard line.
He just ran over Darren Miller, number 45, who was the right inside linebacker. He stepped up to hit Easley. Watch this. Here comes Easley, a little crossfire action, and bang, he hits Miller. He goes down. Just kept right on running. Didn't even slow him down.
That is his seventh carry of this year. That is how little he has been used. Remembering that Jerry Mays is out, Corey Carter is out, the first two tailbacks, as Tony Robinson is out for Tennessee. First down. Now this is Mack looking for running room, and he cuts back and gets 5 or 6 yards. And this defense that Johnny Majors loves so well and did so well against Auburn has not given up a score yet in that a touchdown, but they've given up a field goal. But they have been giving up yardage to Georgia Tech.
We saw Easley run with the football. Now let's look at him block. Here goes Easley up into the hole. And the same guy again, he went after Darren Miller. He gets right to his feet. Miller ends up helping out on the tackle, but that was enough to hold him. They picked up 6 yards.
And it was second down and about four from the 36-yard line. Dewberry's going to throw on second down and four. He can run if he wants, but now he gets the ball away, and that was intercepted or not. Yes, it is intercepted, and intercepted by Chris White. That is his fifth interception of the year. Three of his interceptions came in the first game against UCLA. Dewberry, I believe, could have run for the first down, but chose not to.
And if he would have thrown downfield to Toby Pearson, Jim, he was wide open because White left Pearson alone. Here goes Dewberry. He's going to scramble out of the pocket. He goes to his left. He's trying to throw the ball down here to Massey, I believe, number 81. Yes. Now, White makes the interception, but beyond White down the field was Pearson.
Last two possessions by Georgia Tech, they've turned the ball over once on a fumble and once on an interception as Pete Davis carries the ball out to the 45-yard line, a pickup of four, second down and five. Remember, there was a bad snap at the 33 and now an interception at the 40. Otherwise, Georgia Tech may have more points on the board. Bill Curry knows as well as we do that Tennessee has had a great record this year in plus, on the plus side of turnovers. That's one of the reasons why they've done so well 3-1-1. They have taken the ball away more than they've given it away. Pete Davis and Charles Wilson with the setbacks on second down at about six, and now the fake by Dickey, and he is in trouble and puts the ball up. Now rolling down and saying something should happen is Charles Wilson, but I just think both men were diving for the ball, and I saw no illegal contact at all.
And Jim, you know who the man was covering him, covering Wilson? Roof. But here they come on the outside. Here comes Swilling from the outside, and look at Dickey is running for his life. He throws and he gets hammered. But watch this. The man I'm talking about, the coverage, this is Roof. He's covering Wilson. This is where the trip is. That's incidental accidental. Is it accidental? The contact. Roof was there. If the ball would have been on target, he'd have had an interception.
The ball was not on target, which is a big reason why no flag was thrown. Third down and five. They get the ball to Davis, and he's down, and they're shutting down Keith Davis. Beautiful job done there as Davis hit the line of scrimmage. So did the Georgia Tech defense, led by Parker. And it's fourth down. And here comes Garmon to punt one more time.
Jim, we talked so much at the beginning of the show about what a great defensive game this is going to be. And here comes Roof, but the guy in front of him is going to make the play, and it's number 84, Parker. And there's Roof. Just finish it off. Some kind of day. He's going to have 50 tackles before this thing's over.
Garmon's going to have 50 punts before this thing is over. Little pooch punt, and that is Lee at the 20-yard line, almost at the same spot where they started before, only to lose the ball at the 40 on an interception. 7:31 to go in the second quarter. 3-0, Tech leads Tennessee. Now that man there has got a Georgia Tech hat on. Now he's got a Tennessee hat on.
Well, he puts the Georgia Tech hat on when they get the ball, and he puts the Tennessee hat on. He plays no favorites, King.
First down. Handed off to Malcolm King, who got maybe a couple of yards, and that is all. Kelly Ziegler, the inside linebacker, put him down. 7:20 to go. Now, Tennessee, they played four teams in a row that were all nationally ranked when they played them. Not in a row, I should say, but four teams, including Auburn. Florida and Alabama and UCLA. Tyrone Sorrells is in the tight end. He's been hurt lately, but they pitch the ball back instead to Kelce, and Kelce rolls out. Oh, they're beginning to pick up big yardage, and they're not going straight ahead. They're taking a step or two to the outside and cutting it upfield and doing an outstanding job against Tennessee.
Absolutely right, Jim. They must have talked this thing over and said the over-pursuing of the Tennessee defensive secondary and linebackers, because they are so quick to get outside. What they're running, they took Kelce that time. He takes about four steps to the outside. It looks like a sweep, and they're just cutting everything back inside. He picked up about 8 yards on the play.
You just wonder, with that kind of pursuit, about a reverse now and then.
You're getting to be a coach, isn't it?
Third and short, about a half a yard. And Malcolm King has got it. Across the 30-yard line. Clock clicks down to 6:03 in the half. Georgia Tech on a field goal. In the first 3 minutes of the ball game, leads 3-0. They failed on yet another try.
Here comes the right guard, Bearden. He comes back to the outside, and he gets the block on Kimbrough that opens up the hole, and Malcolm King picks up the first down. Now there's blocking in front. That's Carter, number 43. But Bearden gets a good block, and so does Massey, number 81.
Carter has come back in as one of the running backs, number 43. And on first down, here's Dewberry, and he is throwing over here, and this ball is completed to number 88, Toby Pearson, a sophomore. He has not played in the last four games because of a knee, but started this game and made that catch. Johnny Majors, he knew he's going to be in a ball game here tonight. And if he can get by this ball club, then he's got Rutgers, Memphis State, Ole Miss, Kentucky, and Vanderbilt, and a great chance to win the rest of them. But this is a big, big hurdle right here. And Kentucky always is for Tennessee. Second down and five to go. Wow, hit in the backfield by Darren Miller is Malcolm King. Miller is the leading tackler, and he showed you why there.
It's called getting met in the hole, and he just hammered him before he came in. Got to put the ball up again. Don't worry about the short pass, and don't forget about your tight end, because they're playing the tight end, especially when Georgia Tech takes two wide receivers to one side. They're playing the tight end out here with one-on-one with Kramer, number one.
Third down and four. Newberry rolling out, throwing a little pass out there, and Carter caught the ball, but doesn't get the first down, I do not believe, as Terry Brown, number 14, put him down.
Jim, here's a case of really not knowing where you are on the field. Now, Carter is going to make this catch. It's a little bootleg pass to the outside. Bearden is out in front of Newberry. Now, watch. Here comes Carter. If he turns straight upfield now, he's got a first down. But Terry Brown was there to stop it. We're not going to have another 22-punt game, are we?
I hope not. Mike Snow is only out for his second punt. Already Garmin has punted five times for Tennessee. Fourth down and short. And Snow, because they know they got better than a half to go, and they're playing very well, and he's been kicking well. Kramer goes over and watches the ball hit and bound out of bounds. And with 3:42 going in the first half, Georgia Tech on top of Tennessee by three. And now Tennessee will try to get some kind of drive going. They haven't had one all night. Injuries are a part of football, but you'd never like to hear about any injury to anyone. It's a shame. From the 26-yard line, they've got Howard and Wilson as the setbacks. Maybe Dickey will throw. They don't have Davis in there. Dickey's got the ball. He's going to throw and does throw. And has his man wide open, Jeff Smith, the tight end. First down, 45-yard line, the biggest play of the night for Tennessee.
Jim, I told you we were in the break that they just have to throw the football. They've got to get Georgia Tech out of that tough run defense that they were in. And that time they had Jeff Smith, the tight end. If it was successful for Georgia Tech, why not use it for Tennessee? Here comes Dickey. This is just a nice soft pass right in the hands of Smith. Smith turned around, faced the ball, made the catch, and they're at the 45-yard line of Tech.
Howard and Davis now in there. Check that Wilson and Davis. On first down. Yep, man. And that is Wilson, and Wilson gets 5 or 6 yards. That loosened up that defense a little bit.
Get you thinking, you know, you get one play that picks up about 30 or 40 yards, and all of a sudden you start thinking about pass defense, and it gets those linebackers out of there. Once you block the defensive lineman, now you've got a little room to run.
Dickey, 4 of 6 for 37 yards. Howard and Wilson apparently are bringing in the plays because they're interchanging on almost every play. Second down, 5 to go. Tech by 3. Keith Davis, and boy, that is a neat tackle there because he had that whole sideline available to him, but Ted Roof again in on the tackle. Number 93.
You're right about the sideline, because if Ted Roof, number 93, if he doesn't make this tackle, Davis may still be running. Here it comes. Just take a look at the inside linebacker pursuing back to the outside. First of all, he stops the first down, and I've got to believe he saved the touchdown.
Third down and a couple of yards only, and the power eye for the first time tonight.
Got a safety blitz coming.
And Davis, and he doesn't get it. Davis started his jump about one step in. Roof got underneath him, and he came down a yard or two short.
He was getting ready to go up, and it's where one of those babies where you don't get your back broken because it's wide open. Watch who's down at the bottom is Roof, number 93. Here comes Davis. He hits Roof in the head, and when you flipped over, he gets a shot in the back by Anderson, number 91. Watch this. Two fullbacks in there. There's Roof on the bottom, hits him with his head. There's the tackle.
Remember, halftime, Bob Lee will be around with all the scores. Fourth down, Tennessee called the timeout. They're going to try to get the first down on 4th and 2.
Here's where the backside guy better not forget about the quarterback.
Quarterback's got the ball. They didn't forget about him, and he doesn't get it. Dickey simply spun around, and there was no deception at all there. Parker was all over it. They sent Davis to the right. Dickey spun that way and kept on spinning, and Parker just nailed it.
Jim, what happened? This play takes too long. It's in the almost like a goal line defense. Watch, he'll turn this way and face you. Now he comes back the other way on the fake. There was just no time. It gave Parker enough time, number 84, to get into the backfield and make the play, along with Hogan.
Mark Hogan, let's not forget him. So Tennessee fails on the first down attempt. 1:55 to go, Tech by three. We're in the first half. And frankly, it has been all Georgia Tech. The only score, though, came on the opening kickoff when Tennessee fumbled and Georgia Tech came up with a 3-point. Other than that, on the scoreboard, it's been even. Statistically, it belongs to Georgia Tech, but they've turned the ball over twice themselves on drives. Davenport, the man in motion. Ball handed straight ahead to Charles Mack, and he... And time running down, Richard Cooper in on that play. By the way, Paul has been talking of Ted Roof. 5 unassisted tackles and 4 assists, so far. Wow. Number 93 of Georgia Tech. They split the back on 2nd down and 7. And Dewberry shows a willingness to put it up. Now he shows a willingness to run. Stepped out of one man, and he's got the first down. John Dewberry out near the 49-yard line before Kelly Ziegler caught up with him. And now Georgia Tech's going to call a timeout.
Jim, we're looking at the other linebacker that's so good for Tennessee. This is Jones. Now, he's moving upfield. Ivan Meyer is the man that's after him. Jones misses the tackle. You see the strength of Dewberry's legs. He gets through, gets downfield. Ziegler finally makes the play. They got a first down. I don't understand. They got to throw the ball.
The timeout was, of course, to move the sticks. Georgia Tech did not call it. It's an official timeout. Now the ball is handed off. And that is Malcolm King trying to do something. And Dale Jones is hanging on to him, along with Richard Cooper. We're inside the 55-second mark, and now Georgia Tech calls timeout. Next week, Paul and I go down to the state of Texas. SMU, which rolled over Texas today, will play Texas A&M, which has only lost a game in the conference. And Texas A&M also had a big victory today. That's where we will be next Saturday evening, 7:30 Eastern time, here on ESPN with CFA football. First down, Georgia Tech. Tennessee has not come close to scoring. They've not tried a field goal yet. And this is the ball club, remember, that scored 38 points against Auburn, 26 against UCLA, 16 against Alabama, 10 against Florida in their only losing effort. And thus far, Johnny Major's outfit has not threatened. Not at all.
Not threatened? All right, now let me tell you something. We talked about a defensive football game at the beginning, Jim, and they're both going to be waiting on each other. So far in this game, there's 51 seconds left to go in the second quarter. Tennessee, total, 84 yards. Georgia Tech, total, 144. And they've got to throw the football. They still have one more timeout, Tech. They're in great field position. Go ahead and let it go.
And remember, Johnny Major's group playing without Tony Robinson, but that'll be a fact for the rest of the year. He is gone, and he is still in the hospital. What a down in the training room, or rather the training table where the Tech team eats to see outside where they eat on the bulletin board, the room number and the name of the hospital where Tony Robinson, their fine quarterback, is. But then Collier Mays are out, at least for this game, and maybe more for Georgia Tech. They're 1-2 punches running back. 2nd down and long, and they may have taken too long. Or did someone jump? Because there was timeout, could not have taken too long. But they say they did. Coming out of a timeout, they took too long to get a playoff. Halftime tonight, Miami. Howard Snellenberger goes back to where he created a national champion, and Miami is putting it to him 17-0 at the half. California ahead of UCLA 7-3 in the second quarter.
Delay a game, the offense.
Delay of game, the ball back at the 43-yard line now. 2nd down, 16, 51 seconds to go.
They have to throw that ball at tight end going across the middle.
First inning, no score in the 6th game of the World Series. They're back in Kansas City. That is easily in motion, and Dewberry rolling out. Got to get out of the way of the referee there. Still rolling out, still throwing, and he's going to throw to the far sideline. Caught out of bounds over there, if caught at all, by Gary Lee. In hot pursuit were Sims and Brown. 42 seconds left in the half.
Seems that every time that Dewberry runs, he's running for his life when he rolls out. All right, here they come downfield. That's Pearson and the man on the outside, Gary Lee, number 33. Now, here's the shot to the outside. First of all, that ball is way outside. No, Jimmy wouldn't have had any chance at it.
Well, it is third down and 16 and 42 seconds left. This crowd here, they've been on their feet, but rather subdued. Their team, and it's a good team, has not been able to move the ball. Third down.
Please throw the tight end.
Easily, they hand the ball off instead. That'll run some time off the clock as Mac carries it. And let's see if Tennessee calls some timeout now. They will, so that they can get the ball with some time to do something with it. 33 seconds to go. We saw that UCLA is in a battle with California. Let's check with Bob Lee.
Jim, we told you in the pregame, every time these teams meet, Cal gives the Bruins a tough tussle. Brian Bedford of the Golden Bears to Vince Delgado, 17 yards for the touchdown. 7-3 now. California working on the upset at the Rose Bowl. Back to Knoxville.
Bob, we'll be coming back to you, well, in 33 seconds of playing time for all of the college football scores and, of course, SportsCenter with all of the sports news around the country. And the unsung heroes, college football's trainers. We almost see too much of them, and that's not the downgrade what they do. It's the fact that there have been so many injuries. Andre Kramer goes deep now, and Mike Snow is back for his third punt.
You know, you're talking about trainers?
Here's a balloon floating down in front of it. See if the officials see it and call time. Floating right between Snow and the line of scrimmage. Yep, and we'll let it keep on floating.
It's a little high, the balloon. You're talking about trainers? There's been a trainer for the Buffalo Bills for 26 seasons. And you know him, Eddie Abramowski, one of the best in the business.
Standing back on his own 18-yard line.
Here they come.
Snow will punt from his 31. 10 men, as Paul has indicated, up front. 10 men, but they're peeling back. And Kramer, no fair catch called for. Looking for somewhere to go, and not much to go at all. He's knocked down at the 25-yard line by Rosamila, number 13. And they'll have 21 seconds to go. Bo Jackson today with 169 yards. In other games this year, Jackson has had 290, 242, 240, 205, and today 169 against Mississippi State. And Chuck Long, he put his oar and said, don't forget me out here at Iowa. 6 touchdowns today and 21 on the year. And look, only 8 interceptions against 21 touchdowns and nearly 68% of his passes completed. First down, let's see what Dickey does now. Hands the ball off, hoping that they can get something going running, and Keith Davis brings it out across the 35-yard line with 13 seconds to go. That should be a first down and stop the clock until they move the sticks.
They took a timeout to run a draw.
don't look at me.
I just thought maybe they're going to go up and throw the ball.
There goes Tim McGee. He has caught one tonight and was almost immediately buried as soon as he caught it in the flat. Didn't pick up anything on it. They've not been able to throw the ball long, even with Robinson in there the last couple of games. Here is Dale Dickey. And now he throws and has a man in the seam as the half has ended with the ball at midfield as McGee made the catch. So after the fumble on the kickoff by Panuska, there was a field goal kick by Thomas Palmer of Georgia Tech, and that has been it. At the end of the half, Georgia Tech leads Tennessee by the score of 3-0. We'll come back with a look at the Tennessee band, but now with all the scores in sports news, here is Bob Lee. In our opinion, in just a moment, has the ball taken away from him up there near the 20-yard line. And flying out is Tennessee's Jeff Powell. Well, Tennessee won the toss to begin the game, deferred their option until the second half. They gave it to Georgia Tech, and Georgia Tech said, we'll kick off, meaning we like our black watch defense. We think they can hold you. Well, as it turned out, they got a break when Panuska fumbled that kickoff, and that led to the only score of the game. It is 3-0 Georgia Tech. Ball at the 32-yard line, and Dale Dickey brings him out again. Taking to Davis. Taking another pass, and now it's going to go down near the 34-yard line after a gain of about 2. Tennessee, their possessions in the first half amounted to nothing at all. On the 20, after three plays, they punted. On the six-yard line, six plays, they punted. After three from the 20, they punted. Getting boring in it. After three from 34, they punted. After three from the 40, they punted. And after five plays, they lost it on downs. And then they ran out of time at halftime. They never came close inside the 35-yard line of Georgia Tech in the entire first half. Dickey to throw again, throws it out here to Keith Davis, hands him out, and Davis breaks one tackle and gets to the 38-yard line. It'll be third down and about four to go.
Jim, we look at these halftime stats, and when you just take a look at 52 yards passing for Tennessee, that does not tell a story. Dickey's come out two times in the second half trying to throw the football. Once he ran, once he threw. But he was 5 out of 7. They must let him throw the football to spread out that Tech defense. The defense is sitting there reading run, and as long as they do that, they're going to stop Davis.
Swanson wide to left and McGee to the right. He's been averaging better than 20, almost 23 yards a catch, but not much tonight. Over the last couple of games, here's the throw across the middle, and the ball is caught by the tight end, Jeff Smith. And Jeff Smith got a first down at the 48-yard line. And Tennessee came out throwing, and it moved the football.
Three straight times. The first time, Dickey runs the ball, but the next two times, he throws. One time to Davis, now to Jeff Smith. Here goes the tight end. He fakes it towards the middle to hold the linebacker to the inside. Then he breaks back to the outside. When he does that, he's open. They pick up the first down.
Howard and Wilson bringing in the play. Smith, the tight end, sets up on the other side. Here's Keith Davis. And wow, he did not get back to the line of scrimmage. Hit, first of all, by Cleve Pounds. And then the rest finished him off, including Roof up top. But Pounds was underneath.
Here's the man we were talking about. 9 tackles in the first half. Look at Roof. He's got his eye on nothing but the ball carrier. He gets in, and Davis goes down. He lost 2 yards on the play.
And you can see to your left there, Pounds is the man who hit him first and set him up for Roof, who's having an outstanding night. And I mean Roof. Second down and 12.
Jim, look at the play selection. 72% passing. We thought it would be the other way around for Tennessee.
Well, the run has not worked. Dickey in trouble, and down he goes. He is definitely in the grasp there, and that is Ken Parker, a senior out of Titusville, Florida, number 84. And now suddenly it is third down and about 20.
The graphic was just backwards, Jim. It was the run. They were running the ball like we thought they would. Okay, Ken Parker, number 84, is going to come in from the outside right there. He just runs over the tackle that's sitting on the outside trying to block him. Was that David Douglas? He went out, but is he back in?
I thought that was Eric Still, 79,
well, you're
78.
Probably right. Tough seeing these things, you know.
And Still is a freshman. Third down and nearly 20 to go. Dickey must throw this time. Does throw to keep Davis. Flag down. Could be holding back at the 30. If so, it'll be third down and about 30 to go. But they might just say, look, it's fourth down, 11, let them kick it back. But the field position would be so good, they might be tempted to take the distance.
As well as this defense is playing, Jim, they're gonna refuse the penalty, I think. But you would seriously think about it, because Tennessee can't do much.
On the offense.
They're going to refuse.
Fourth down.
Keep in mind now that the Volunteers of Tennessee have not been inside the 35-yard line of Georgia Tech all night long. And back for yet another kick is Bob Garman. This is number 6. And Gary Lee steps back inside his own 25-yard line. Now he's back inside his 20. One field goal. It's all that's been scored in the game. That is the result of a fumbled opening kickoff. Both teams in their conference races. Both teams in the races for the bowl bids. We'll start talking about, after all, next Saturday night. It'll be in the month of November. Garman took the ball away. That's a good kick. Fair catch, and Lee will let it go, hoping it goes in the end zone, but it will not go in the zone. And now Georgia Tech, for one of the few times tonight, will be starting with no field position at all. Inside their own 10. Third quarter, Tech leads Tennessee 3-0. The 8-yard line, Georgia Tech, their first possession of the second half. They lead by 3, but they start, as you said, from their 8. Pearson in motion. That is Dewberry, and he's on end zone. Getting out of that, past the five, and out of about the 8 or 9 yard line. Now they're going to mark it back past the 15. I beg your pardon on that. No, they're going to put it back at the 8 or 9. One man ran down. Look at this.
All right, here's the possession. Remember, that was a recovered fumble. They got a field goal out of it after 5 plays. Here we go with Georgia Tech. 3 plays, punt. 8 plays, they missed the field goal. Then they 6 plays, and they fumble the ball. 3 plays, interception. 5 plays, punt. 5 plays, punt. They just had the ball more than all, Jim.
Ball on the 10 is where they finally marked it. Second down and 8. That is Malcolm King, and doesn't he take a few hits as he gets to about the 14-yard line, led by Kelly Ziegler, number 49. So with Jerry Mays out and Corey Collier out, their 1-2 running back, who you may not have been with us in the first half, Malcolm King, Chuck Easley, Charles Mack, Nate Kelsey, and Joe Carter have all been runners for Georgia Tech.
Now, we thought that Georgia Tech would throw the ball more. But that's changed. It's 70% running the ball and 30% passing the ball.
Here's where Tennessee wants to hold and make Snow kick it away. They could get good field position, but they got a hold. 3rd and 4. Dewberry still has the ball. Gets it out here, and the ball is caught, and that should be the first down. Out near the 19-yard line, Mannion, the tight end, put down by Brown and Miller, but that should be a first down. Sims is down and looks like he's hurt.
I think it's Terry. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's Terry Brown. Terry Brown.
Yeah. Mannion, the linebacker. First of all, Dewberry does a great job getting away from everyone. And here comes Mannion underneath. He goes by Ziegler, the one linebacker, by the other linebacker, Miller, number 45. And then Dewberry sees him. Now here comes Terry Brown. He's the man that hits. He knows they have a first down, but then he goes back down. He's still on his face.
Next Saturday night, Paul and I'll be deep in the heart of Texas. SMU, which clobbered Texas today against Texas A&M, which had an easy ride against Rice today. 7:30 Eastern time down there in that Southwestern Conference battle. From the 19-yard line, it is a first down.
Terry Brown's all right, Jim. He's just down there moving his shoulder around, so he did take a lick on the arm.
Davenport, the man in motion. Oh, my. Ziegler just really piles up the running offense of Georgia Tech. Paul, the defense is charged up. I'll let you talk about this first.
Well, look at Kelly Ziegler. This time he doesn't overrun the play. He just sits in there and waits for Mack, and then he's in the backfield. There's no gain on the play, but Ziegler is the man.
I get the impression that Tennessee's defense, which has already gotten a fumble and an interception figure, they need a turnover down here to give their offense some kind of impetus, some kind of good field position. That's what they're battling for. 2nd down and 10. Davenport in motion. Dewberry hands off, and that is Malcolm King, and he's not going anywhere. It'll be 3rd down and about 9. And Dale Jones doing his best to rev everybody up. Kimbrough made the stop, the freshman, number 55.
And another man that got in as the free safety was White, number 7, came back in from the outside and took a shot at him.
All right, they bring in Gary Lee and Toby Pearson again. They're two best wide receivers. And let's just see how much gambling Dewberry will do against this nickel defense with a line of scrimmage his own 20. 3rd and 9. Dewberry not under a rush. Gets the ball away, and it is dropped. Intended for his tight end, Mannion, who cannot hold on to it at the 32-yard line. Hit there by the inside linebackers, Ziegler and Miller, and that's one of the reasons Mannion couldn't hold on.
Well, that ball hits Mannion right in the hands. He was beyond the 30-yard line. He was in perfect position. Dewberry put the ball right on his numbers. He just dropped it.
Snow, who's been kicking well, needs one here. He's back up to his own 6. Andre Kramer standing his own 42, anticipating that Tennessee will have the best start of the night. High and deep, driving Kramer back to about the 35-yard line. And he's in trouble back there. Does not get out to the 40. 8:57 to go. We're in the third quarter. Georgia Tech holding on to a slim 3-0 lead over Tennessee. Voila. I'll bet you all the Tennessee alumni around the country will say what that is before I do. That is Ayers Hall, and that is the home of those folks who come here as undergraduates to take liberal arts on the campus of Tennessee. And Dickey's got the ball to throw on first down. He is being pursued, and he's in trouble, but gets the ball away. And that is Howard. And Howard does not get back to the line of scrimmage. Only about to the 35-yard line. It'll be second down and 14. And the offense of Tennessee tonight has been sputtering without their regular quarterback.
Well, that's not really the problem. The problem, they're not blocking for him. They're just after him. That is Swilling, number 99, that's in his face, in Dickey's face. He finally dumps the ball off to Howard, but they lose 4 or 5 yards on this play.
And almost lost the ball. 3-0, Georgia Tech, Tennessee with the ball at their own 35-yard line. Second down, 14. We're in the third quarter. And Dickey, blocking for him now, gets the ball out there and throws it behind his tight end, Jeff Smith. Third down and 14.
Now, that's the quarterback's fault, that play there, because he did have Jeff Smith going across the middle underneath. He was wide open.
His numbers are okay, 9 of 12, and he is a leader, but you're right. Swilling and Parker have been in the backfield, and Roof has been bedeviling nearly everybody, running backs and Dickey alike. Tennessee's finding it tough. They are proud of their defense, but that black watch defense had held Auburn to 17 points last week. As Georgia Tech in this game. Here's Dickey back. At the time again. Now besides running will not get it for him. Running will not. It's going to be fourth down and a long way to go. Cleve Pounds takes him out of bounds. Tennessee will have to give up the ball again.
I think Cleve Pounds is not a hitter. Here we go. Watch here. Now Davis is going to see him run. See Dickey run now. He's going to try to block on Pounds. That's wrong. And here's Pounds. Pounds is pounding Dickey.
He goes back, and here's that man again, Bob Garman, from punt number 7. The ball away. Lee back at the 16-yard line. He's back across the 20 to about the 23, and Georgia Tech's got the ball back again. 8:19 to go in the third quarter. Georgia Tech by 3 on a balmy night in Knoxville, Tennessee. Live, the National Hockey League continues tomorrow night here on ESPN at 7 o'clock Eastern Time. The Minnesota North Stars and the Buffalo Sabres. You ought to know a lot about the Sabres, Paul. That's your old hometown, your old team.
The new coach this year, Jim Schoenfeld. What a great job he's doing.
That's tomorrow night at 7 here on ESPN. Team has put together a march of significance. Georgia Tech twice went into Tennessee territory, only lose the ball on a fumble and an interception. And now Malcolm King carries for a few yards across the 25 to about the 27, with Richard Cooper, number 77, hanging on down at the bottom. And as you can see, a little help also from Brian Kimbrough, number 55, the linebacker.
Jim, I think Georgia Tech could be a little bit more effective if they would throw the ball on first down instead of waiting to third down, where Dewberry is really running for his life, because every time it's third down and long, that defensive line of Tennessee, they're just teeing off and going after him. He's got to make great plays just by dodging defensive linemen in order to throw the ball. Throw it.
Thank you. He heard you. Was it out here to his back? Oh, Malcolm King is put down by Terry Brown, the man who was down himself a little while ago. And that's a loss on the play, and it is third down and 10. Put it back at the 23. As time goes on, Paul, and there is no score here, you keep looking for the unusual, the bizarre play. This was not one of them.
Well, Porter, the guard, 62. See him? He never gets out into the play to help Malcolm King. And Terry Brown just did a great job as the right corner. Got up, got behind the guard, and made the tackle in the backfield for a loss of 3.
You keep looking. Well, it's too early now for what they call a gadget play. Somebody's got to come up with some offense somewhere. And now, Dewberry does not have the ball, hands it off to Easley, and he does not have the first down either. As Charles Davis, the free safety, put him down along with Tommy Sims, and here we go again as Mike Snow comes in to punt the ball away.
Jim, they ran that play with Easley, right? But Charles Mack got a sensational block on Dale Jones, number 54. First of all, he got him out of the play. Then he ran up behind him when he was looking at Easley going down and hit him in the back and knocked him down.
There's Andre Kramer backing up inside his 35-yard line. Snow standing on his own 16. Well, Both teams are proud of their defenses, and you can see why in this game, but their offenses being dominated high and not too far as Kramer comes up. No fair catch called for, and he's dragged down at the 36 to 37 yard line. 6:12 to go, make it 6:11. Third quarter, same old score, 3-0. Seeing a lot of good defense tonight. First down from the 37, Tennessee trailing by three, and that is Power being stood up by Roof. Ran right into Ted Roof at the 40-yard line. Pickup of 2.5 on the play. It is second down. Keith Davis is not in there. Their nifty tailback, nothing wrong with him. He's wandering the sidelines.
Jim, when you talk about Roof, does he get great position? Watch how square he is up with the field. Now he sees him come in, and bang, he hits Howard head-on. No yardage after that play. Tennessee went on a quick count, Jim, tried to get Georgia Tech out of position, and they sent down Swanson, number 27, downfield. Nothing happened.
Miami, no, look over Howard Schnellenberger. Welcome back to Miami, Howard. 38-0 in the third quarter. UCLA now out in front of California, 20-7, and that's at the half of what they expected. And they're in the fifth inning now. They've started the sixth, and there's still no score, so LeBron and Cox are pitching very well. If Kansas City wins, they go to seventh game tomorrow night. If those wins, of course, it is all over. Third down and long to go. One more time for Tennessee from the 39-yard line this time. And Del Dickey is back to throw. Got a man out here in the flat, but he doesn't see him. Well, he can make the first down, but he falls short of the first down. He took his slide about a yard short of the first down marker. Flag is across the field at the 43 on the other side.
We may have holding on the defense, which will give him a first down. Jim, we are, you know, when you're looking at this game, you're not seeing the defenses or offenses playing that poorly. No flag. They're going to throw it away.
Well, it's going to be fourth down and one.
But what I'm saying is, you said it just before this play. We're seeing great defense by both Tennessee and by Georgia Tech. Take a look at Dickey here. He has no idea where he is. He must know where that first down marker is. He knows he's going to take a shot, but he didn't intentionally fall down, Jim.
He slipped, didn't he?
And Mark Hogan was right there.
Yeah, let's take it away from that. We apologize, Gerald. You slipped down. This is the eighth punt for Bob Garman. That's another good one. And let that go, Gary Lee. Will it get into the end zone? This may be another break for Tennessee. It's going to be. It will not make it into the end zone. Out of about the 5-yard line. And for the second time, on a punt by Garman, Georgia Tech will start inside their own 10. 5:14 to go. Tennessee defense looking for the big break.
Jim, when we watch this punt from where we are way up. But when you watch this punt, that nose of the ball gets over. And when that nose of the ball got over, he had his head down. He had his toe down. Now watch it. That ball hit that surface. It didn't hit the ball back. It just took a right angle turn. It just went right out of bounds at the 5-yard line. That's beautiful. Throw the ball.
John Newberry will come down here.
Throw it.
Newberry's not going to throw it that easily, and he is dragged down by Fisher, an inside linebacker. Wassier Fisher, a senior out of Nashville. 94,575 paid to get in here tonight. I'll do that again. 94,575.
My brother's here, and his eight people, his family all snuck in.
So that takes it 94,583. Second down, eight to go. And that is Malcolm King underneath there. You can see Kelly Ziegler down there along with him. And also looks like Fisher, number 40, is also getting up. It'll be third down.
Jim, Malcolm King just slipped when he went into the hole because it looked from here like that hole was open. It was there. And when he made that turn, that field's not wet.
It is third down and six to go.
Double tight end again.
Checked by three, but deep in their own territory. Lee in motion. Newberry with the ball. Newberry puts it up at the sidelines, and hey, look at Gary Lee. First down, what a catch. Back to the sidelines, kept his feet in, and goes out.
Jubari is rolling to the outside, and he gets some blocking help from his people in the backfield. They do a great job. And then the catch by Gary Lee was super because he turns his ball back, his body back to the ball. All right, now watch here. Jubari goes out to the outside. He's getting good blocking at the line of scrimmage. He has time to turn upfield, get his body straight, and then Gary Lee just makes a super catch on the outside.
Back line, the ball at the 25-yard line. Jubari hands off this time to Malcolm King, and look at him being submarined by Kelly Ziegler. After a second down and eight. Check of the clock, 3:43 to go. Third quarter, Tech by 3 points. And nobody has put together a drive tonight. Nobody. The only 3 points came on the fumbled kickoff by Tennessee to start the game. And I must say that Jubari missed his tight end in the end zone for what could have been a touchdown. It was wide open. But it played very well. Second man through. This may be one of the best runs of the night. Malcolm King carries the ball out with Terry Brown hanging on, but that's another first down at the 38-yard line.
You know why this play works, Jim? Because they block the two inside linebackers, Miller 45 and Ziegler 49. Now, take a look at the two of them there. Now, watch what happens. Miller gets kicked to the outside. Okay, here comes Ziegler. He's being blocked on this side by Weaver, number 78. When you take those two guys out, it opens up the hole.
Georgia Tech started this at their own 5-yard line. They're now at the 38. Mannion is the tight end. That's Pearson in motion and a quick handoff. And that is Mack back in the ball game. Charlie Mack from Decatur. Big, strong man. Not so tall, but 195 at 5'11", and a very, very strong running back. Ball at the 42-yard line.
Mack almost ran that play a little bit too wide because Jubari just about missed him with the football.
Second down and six. That's Dewberry's numbers. 9 of 15 for 81 yards. One interception. And here's Easley looking for some running room, and there's another good play by Ziegler. Following down the line and making the good play, and all of a sudden it is third down and still about 6 yards to go.
Jim, we've talked about Miller, Darren Miller, 45, Kelly Ziegler, 49 for Tennessee, and we talk about Ted Roof, number 93 for Georgia Tech. Those inside linebackers, you're not going to run wide unless you take those people down. We saw the one play where it worked and they got a first down. That time that one blocked Ziegler, he made the tackle.
Remember, Tennessee is the team that clubbed Auburn, and Auburn barely got by Georgia Tech last week. By 3 points. These are two good ball clubs, and the bowl scouts are here, make no mistake. Third down and five to go, and Jubari has the time and has a man wide open. Gary Lee, first down at the 37. That's the second third down play on this drive that Jubari's found Lee. Once to the right sideway, back out of bounds, and this time to the left.
So, Jim, they didn't get to the outside. Number 22, Charles Davis, he never covers Gary Lee. Gary Lee got in front of the corner and behind the corner in front of the safety, and there is Davis. He just does not make the play.
Nate Kelsey is in as the up back, the fullback, number one, on first down. Davenport, the man in motion, and they get the ball to King, and King's got some running room and gets down near the 31-yard line. Now this is five in the night. This started at the 5-yard line of Georgia Tech, and now they've got second down at the 31-yard line of Tennessee. 1:14 to go in the third quarter. Fisher and DeLong are the linebackers. Miller and Ziegler are out of there. Ziegler came out kind of wobbly.
See that stat after three quarters, 17% running the ball, Georgia Tech, and they didn't think they could run.
Four down territory again. King very quickly, and the fellow that makes things happen, Dale Jones, was right there. He's the man, as we said, intercepted the pass, recovered a fumble, made seven tackles last week against Alabama.
Okay, number 54, Dale Jones, and the play is there. The only good thing about this play, Jim, Dale Jones comes down the line and makes a stop, is that they put the ball in the middle of the field for the field goal.
Thomas Palmer has made a 22-yard field goal, missed a 35-yarder, and now will try a 38-yarder. Bell has come in. That is not Palmer. Bell was a regular kicker, and he comes in, and he does it. Bell comes in.
He has been hurt. Started the season, got hurt, comes in and kicks a big field goal. With 13:02 to go in the fourth quarter, it is 6-0. Tennessee trails Georgia Tech. And David Bell never hit a bigger one. Just saw the bridge and the river and the stadium in Tennessee were taken during the daylight hours. Mo Davenport, who does our pregame and halftime features, our producer for those, he adds those little shots during the daytime so you can see these different campuses. In fact, Mo and all of his crew. And now Jeff Powell is back there, not Panuska. Powell at the 2-yard line, 15-yard line, and out across the 20-yard line. And Tennessee now has 12:55 to go, lots of time left. One touchdown puts them ahead. But I tell you, that Black Watch defense of Georgia Tech has been outstanding tonight. But that was the longest drive of the night, starting at the 5-yard line, culminating with a 38-yard field goal.
Jim, in the first half, Tennessee total yardage, they had 109 yards. The end of the third quarter, they had 131 yards. That tells you Georgia Tech's defense.
22 yards in the third quarter only for Tennessee. Darrell Dickey, Howard, and Pete Davis back in there. That's a running back. And apparently, either audible there or they didn't know what the signal was. This is Keith Davis, and this time he's got some running room. And that's a fine play there by Cleve Pounds. As Keith Davis has one of his better runs of the night, picking up perhaps 5 yards, second down and 5. Well, that's about second down and 6, and spot the ball at the 26-yard line. Keith Davis, 45 yards on 16 carries. He has got 3 100-yard gains, but unless he rips one from here, he's got no shot at it tonight. And there is Smokey the Sixth. We told you that the Reverend W.C. Brooks has been providing those Rutic Coonhounds to Tennessee for 33 years now. Now a throw there to Simmons, the All-American, and look out. Big play, Simmons, first down, Tennessee, across the 40-yard line. I said, Simmons, it's McGee, apologies. Tim McGee, the All-American.
They finally got the ball to McGee and gave him a little bit of running room, but now we're looking at Ted Roof. Look, steps up into the line of scrimmage, hits Kirk to center. Now he's trying to get away from Kirk. Watch this. He gets to the outside. He's got his eyes set on McGee, gets a piece of McGee, spins him around, and helps out with a tackle.
Hustle, hustle.
That man is some dangerous weapon if he can get the ball to him. And look, he steps out. Darrell Dickey steps out running. He's got the first down, and this is the best drive of Tennessee. Now a ball is loose, and Georgia Tech says they've got it. But the official stepping in saying, no, you don't. And we'll wait, I'm sure, for Astor Sizemore, our referee. They're still arguing. Tennessee said, we got it. Georgia Tech says, we got it. And the official hasn't said anything yet except Tennessee's got it.
You know who ran him down? Jim? 93. Roof. Watch this. It looks like Dickey's going to get hammered, but he gets out of that tile. And watch from the right of your screen, you're going to see number 93 coming in. He gets a piece of him, but the ball is down, and that's a fumble. That is a fumble.
First down, Tennessee, treading 6-0, 11:32 to go. At the 41-and-a-half-yard line of Georgia Tech, their best drive of the evening, and down goes Davis as Ken Parker has simply smothered him as he hit the line of scrimmage. Parker, 84.
Jimmy, you have the feeling in this game the team that scores a touchdown is going to win it.
I'd like to see one. There's Bill Curry. He would, too, as long as it's been run by the people in gold and black.
Jim, now watch with this ball. He is not on the ground. This ball, he gets hit here, and then the ball goes down. That's Hogan coming in, hitting him, 36. The
ball
is on the ground.
To Georgia Tech.
That ball does belong to Georgia Tech.
Ball belongs to Georgia Tech. No matter what happens, Tennessee fans, you can't get upset with that. They set up the screen over here, and falling down is Keith Davis. He lost 3 yards on the play. It is third down and 13.
So another fumble, because they said that Keith Davis had control of the football. Look where they're marking the ball. And a Tennessee man had enough cool to come back and dive on the ball.
Third down, and let's make it more like 12 than 13, but still a big play. And coming in with the play is Eric Swanson, a wide receiver who whispers to his quarterback, Darrell Dickey. Wilson, the lone setback. Dickey on third and 12, and he's in a
group of people here. And he's not going to make the first down. It'll be fourth down from inside the 40. And I don't have to tell you who number 93 is, I don't think. That's Ted Roof who got him. Great reflexes and quickness for a linebacker.
All right, we're looking at McGee coming downfield now. That's Hogan. He lets him go by. Now, here's McGee is open. There's no question about that. There's only one problem. Gerald Dickey was running for his life. He had no place to go. The man that forced him out was number 94, Spencer.
All right, Carlos Gervais will try one from 55 yards out. He is one for two over the 50-yard mark. From 55 yards out, Gervais puts it up. Has he got it? He does!
Hitting this thing, Jimmy, it's beautiful. It bounces off the goalpost.
Their only score for Tennessee comes from 55 yards away. They trail Georgia Tech by three.
He's not a hero, but every year, thousands of people...
Knoxville, and I'm sure that Paul and I will enjoy, along with the rest of the ESPN crew, our trip down to Texas next week, where Texas A&M is doing very well, thank you, and SMU had some rough patches along the way, but they've now recovered, and they won big today over Texas. SMU and Texas A&M, 7:30 Eastern Time, next Saturday night. A three-point game again. And that's Malcolm King with not much room at all. Well, Vanek was the first, number 59, to hit him, and he got a lot of help along the way.
Jim, a lot of people talk about it. Say, well, you know, how can Tennessee hold on? Their defense has been on the field for an awful long time. So has Georgia Tech's offense. They've been on the field an awful long time. The only time that they're changing people in are they're usually a line or a tight end or a back.
Bill Curry looking on. Second down, the fake to Malcolm King. Dewberry puts it out here to Charles Mack. And Mack is near the first down, loss of football. And let's see, they haven't pointed yet. Tennessee says, Tennessee's bench says.
Tennessee does.
Team had a fumble, wasn't given to him, but this is a fumble, clear and simple, and Tennessee comes up with watch Mack and watch the hit.
Mack gets hammered, and that's Dale Jones, number 54. Looked like Fisher, number 40, who was a backup linebacker behind Darren Miller, that picked it up. We know now that we're in field goal range.
For Reves, I guarantee you. Ball at the 36. And this is the best start that Tennessee has had in their field position tonight. Trailing by three. Dickey still has the ball and now whips it over here. And down goes Keith Davis. Out of bounds, stopping the clock after getting perhaps 5 yards. A lot of that Georgia Tech defense took the fake of Dickey to his running back.
You see swilling that. 99, he was up in Daryl Dickey's face. He couldn't look downfield. He had to look to the outside and hit Davis.
Swilling has 11 sacks on the year, 7 against North Carolina State. Second down and 4 to go. Davis with a head of steam up. He's got the first down inside the 25-yard line. And the recovery of that fumble after the 55-yard field goal to Rebay seems to have rejuvenated this Tennessee team.
And he's fanned.
53 yards for Davis.
Jim, that time Swilling got hooked to the inside. And once he gets hooked to the inside, then there's running room. You see Swilling getting picked up right there. Once they do that, they move back out to the outside. Ingram, number 47, comes in and makes the play, but there's a first down. They're inside the 25.
They take up Jeff Smith, the tight end, put in Vince Carter, a wide receiver. They've got three wideouts on. On a short drop. That's his man. That's like McGee. Number 88. Inside the 15-yard line, close to a first down, they may have to measure. 7:03 to go, 6-3. Tennessee leads and on the move.
Oh, McGee does what? Jimmy will go down about 7 yards. He'll hook up right there. They're right in the seam of the zone defense. No chance to stop him. Hogan was there, number 36, but he let him get to his inside, and they're going to measure it.
Missed it by that much. You would think that the worst Tennessee could come away with is a tie, and at best they'll come away with a 10-6 lead.
Dickey is having a pretty good day.
Oh.
Here's a situation when you have that much. It's almost, well, down here, being behind by three, not a throwaway down, but a great situation to run some kind of play-action pass.
McGee and Carter to the right and Swanson to the left. Again, the three wide out. Now Tennessee calls for his fans to be quiet so they can hear the count. First man through. That is Howard. Howard being held on to there as he went in by Schwitting. That's the first down.
They were looking for something to the outside, and Howard just takes it right up the middle. Just super blocking by that offensive line. They got a piece of everyone, and downfield goes Howard. He's at the 7-yard line. Things are going to get tough.
Here's where the Black Watch defense of Georgia Tech will really be tested. All started with a fumble on the 36-yard line. First man through, does not get it this time. That's Howard again. And you can see Den Dobry, the junior middle linebacker, in there to make the stop.
That's 2 yards.
It is second down and goal to go. The clock, 6:18 and running in the fourth quarter.
Audible, they're going to change calls at the line.
Here's Dickey. He's got the ball, and he audibilized, and he is knocked down there by Ted Roof.
Jim, he misses the handoff to Keith Davis. It was supposed to be a handoff to Davis. Davis ran it too wide, or Dickey didn't get out to him. Watch. Here he comes. He's reaching for Davis. He knows he can't get the ball to him. I think that Davis might have run it a little bit too wide, and look who's sitting in his face. Ted Roof, number 93. Now they have to throw.
Third down and goal to go. Mark the ball at the 8. Clock continues to run less than 5.5 minutes. Big chance for Tennessee.
Roof, 15 tackles so far in this game.
Dickey hands the ball off, and no, Davis does not get it. Now they've got to get the ball across the goal line. Do they go for the tie? Apparently that's what they're going to go for. Gervais is on the field. He has kicked a hit a 55-yarder. There's still a lot of time to play. And Curry, I think, is saying, watch out. Watch out.
Isn't it a little apropos, though, for this football game, as well as these two defenses have played, to end this game in a 6-6 tie?
You can have a first down on the 7, and have to settle for a field goal. That's nearly what Georgia Tech had to do after the recovering the fumble of the kickoff.
Exactly.
They had first down inside the 10, couldn't get it in, settle for the field goal.
We've had two turnovers that are going to be, if they make this field goal, very costly. And they took a delay of game, so they want to move the ball back. But actually, Georgia Tech, they don't have to accept this penalty. They'll probably leave them right there where they are and for a greater angle.
Well, Curry is checking.
Refuse it.
Refuse it, he's saying. You're right.
Okay. Got delay on the offense. It's declined.
Doyle still have an angle from right to left. It'll be a 21-yarder.
Just kicked a 55-yarder. This has got to be a piece of cake. His brother won the game in Miami against Tampa Bay last week.
Baud, who also played here. All right, he does have a slight angle, but he's inside the hash mark toward the middle of the field, 21 yards away. This is to tie the game with 4:23 left. The game is no good from 21 yards away.
Gervais missed it, and they gave him the angle, and he couldn't come through with it.
How smart it is now, Jim, to refuse a penalty and don't give them what they want. Here it is. Gervais just hooks this ball too far to his left. Too much of an angle. He knows that he knew it when he hit it.
Gervais cannot believe he missed a 21-yarder. And, oh, Curry believes it and loves it. 6-3 Georgia Tech. 45-7 in the return of Schellenberger to Miami. And UCLA in gear now, 27-7 over California in the third quarter. And LeBrant of Kansas City has pitched a two-hitter. Cox of St. Louis a seven-hitter. They're in the eighth inning. There is no score in game six of the World Series. Second down and a yard to go for Georgia Tech. Carter is in as the up-back. Pearson, the man in motion. And Carter, the up-back, has it, and Ziegler puts him down.
First down.
But I think he's got the first down just at the 30-yard line. And that will enable Georgia Tech to run another minute or two off the clock, even if they don't pick up the first down.
These two defenses are solid. They really are solid. We knew it. When we knew the game, it was going to be a defensive football game and a tough-hitting football game. And Mr. Ted Roof from Georgia Tech, 93, 15 tackles so far in this game.
Ball, they didn't give him the first down. They marked it just shy of the 30. The nose of the ball is not over. It is third down and short to go. And now it is fourth down, and they'll have to kick the ball away.
Tim, I don't understand why they didn't just run a quarterback sneak with Dewberry. Should have run a quarterback sneak because it's everything is split. They're given the splits by the defensive linemen. And the play, they just come right down the line of scrimmage. It's just a super play on the outside. Is that 99 Howard?
No, that's 98 Richard Brown.
Brown?
But I guarantee you, I thought they'd marked the ball for the first down. Looked like he was across the 30-yard stripe, but they said he was just inches shy. And it is a game of inches, so Mike Snow will kick the ball away again. And Andre Kramer goes again. And maybe Tennessee and Ravens will have a chance again. High, good kick. Good kick. They're down under him. He's that tall. And look at the trouble he is in. And down he goes at the 25-yard line, and a flag goes down. Could be face mask, which will give him 5 yards. 2:05 to go. Tennessee's going to have to get it going. It is a face mask.
Jim, I swear I thought he had him by the back of the jersey, but what do we got here? Face mask?
If you're right or wrong.
All right, there's Kramer down there, and he's running to his right.
Up.
That's face mask.
That is face mask.
That's face mask.
So they'll mark that off, and Tennessee has another shot. They're going to take 10 big ones. 2:05 to go. The ball at the 35. Tennessee down by three, and they got another chance. Lots of time left here in Knoxville.
Not so very long ago.
Yep. Bill Kerr is screaming the same thing I was. 5 yards. So the officials marked it back to the 30. They paced off 10 yards. It is a 5-yard penalty. Here's Dickey back, and the ball is broken up, and that is a good play there by Mark Price. Pike, beg your pardon, number 39, intended for Wilson. But Mark Pike missed it as an end, but they drop off a lot in that scheme of things at Georgia Tech, and he was back there to defend. And knocked the ball away.
Jim Wilson was looking downfield. He was looking for someone to hit him. He would think, look at this here, Jim. These are plays per possession. Georgia Tech, 5.3. Tennessee, 4.1. That's not good offense. That's great defense, boys.
This is not a sluggish game. This is a hard-hitting, fine defensive game. Here's Daniel, and whoops. That was intended for his tight end, Jeff Smith, down at the ground, but it's going to be a flag down in the backfield of Tennessee, and that could be costly. That's going to be holding charge against the Volunteers.
It's third and 10. You take them back. Take them back 10. And that time, Anderson, who is an outside linebacker, or an inside linebacker, the way they played, he's an outside linebacker. He gave Smith a shot in the back, and that's where that ball came out.
You know, if Georgia Tech goes on to win this game, and there's 1:53 left, you got to remember that Tennessee let time run down, delay of game. After consulting with their coach, you saw Bill Curry say, refuse the penalty, let Ravais have the angle, and at the angle, 21 yards out, he missed the field goal to tie the game. That
was a big decision by Bill Curry. And a correct decision. Second down from the 20.
Not bad stats. 13 and 19 for Dixon. Not much yardage, though.
A little short catch. There's Dickey back again.
Screen.
Throwing it out here. They keep Davis on the screen. Davis looking for running room. Gets across the 30-yard line. And it will be third down and about 9 to go. Spencer put him down.
Jim, they're a hurry-up offense for Tennessee. They've got three timeouts. I don't know why they don't take one of them.
1:30, time is running away while they do all of this. And it's third down and long.
They just wasted about 15 seconds.
There's Dickey on third. They need a lot. And Davis did not go out, drop the ball. But he wouldn't have had the first down anyway. Did not go far enough. And guess why? Ted Roof hit it.
Jim,
you know, I wanted to go home tonight and say the roof fell in on us tonight. Because I tell you, Ted has done an outstanding job.
It's got to be a great headline. The roof fell in. They're going for it on fourth down. What's the difference whether you get beat by three or by, what, 10?
1:19 left.
You just gave every sports writer here their opening headline.
Oh, I go back, way back. I've said this before. When Texas beat Alabama, and someone wrote Steers fell on Alabama. Fourth down. There's Dickey, maybe last play for Tennessee, and he overthrows everybody and is intercepted across the way by Rutland. And that may be it. 1:12 to go as Dickey is picked off. 1:12 left. Georgia Tech 6, Tennessee 3. And now, as you look at the replay, Tech will try.
Jim, when Dickey throws this ball to the outside, first of all, the receiver wasn't in the area. But watch what number 16 Rutland does when he catches the ball. He's going to go down. He could have hot dogged a little bit and tried to run with the football. The only thing he made sure of, Jim, that he caught the ball. And Curry?
Oh, yeah. Here we go. Here we go. We got to win.
Malcolm King carries the ball across the 50-yard line. And you can see the clock. And now they may start calling timeout. And here, Paul, Tennessee uses one of its three timeouts. They didn't use any at all when they had the ball. They rushed their offense, and they rushed themselves right out of a possession. Not that it may not have made any difference. We don't know. But they sure could have used a timeout. Last year, playing against Clemson, he bullied William the Refrigerator Perry, but that's because Perry's a running back. I mean, he never should have been playing defensive tackle anyway.
That's right.
But they called Davis a refrigerator mover. He's 292 himself. Here's Dewberry, and he is being just run around, John. It'll take time off the clock. Just don't go out of bounds. Go down. That's right. That took a lot off the clock. About 12 seconds off the clock, and now they will kick the ball away.
It is dangerous, Jim, but that's what they've been doing. That's why when you say, why don't they take a knee, take a knee? Because Tennessee had three timeouts when that thing started. They wanted to run some time off it, and they did that.
First quarter, after the fumbled kickoff by Panuska, Palmer had a 22-yard field goal after Georgia Tech had the ball inside the 10, but first down couldn't do it. Then Bell came on for his first kick in many games, 38-yarder, made it 6-0. Then a turnover at the 35. Well, before that, Reveille's hit one from 55 yards out to make it 6-3. Then the turnover at the 35, and Reveille's missed from 21 yards out. It is 6-3. Johnny Major's team, this would only be their second loss. It's not a Southeastern Conference loss. But they've got Rutgers and Memphis State and Ole Miss and Kentucky and Vanderbilt ahead. I'm sure Tennessee will survive the loss of Tony Robinson. But they have met up with a doggone good Georgia Tech team tonight. I'll tell you that.
Jim, they have to go after this punt. They really do.
Well, they've got 10 men up front. No, the kicker. Low snap. Gets it away. Kramer, no fair catch. And down he goes at the 22-yard line. Pat James put him down. Top of the eighth inning. The Cardinals have moved out in front of LeBrandon, Kansas City, 1-0. They hold on to that. That World Series is over.
40 seconds, no timeouts, but remember, if you haven't watched college football before, every time you get a first down, you move the chains, they stop the clock.
And remember, Reveille, despite missing from 21 yards out, hit one from 50 yards out. A tie is still within the realm of possibility, as is a win. Dickey has gone all the way tonight. Got all the time in the world and drills it and has a man open. And did he get it or not? That's Carter, and they said, yes, he got it with 31 seconds to go. They're not in field goal range now, but they're on their way, they hope.
That took 9 seconds off the clock. And remember, now the clock is stopped. They're moving the chains. His play should be called. Call your audible now while they're moving the chains. As soon as that official puts his hand down, you go. You go on the first snap. Don't try to be funny.
He's going. I don't know, Rush, you better throw the ball. They'll get out of bounds, but that takes time off the clock. Couldn't find anybody, but does stop the clock. Pressures of being a head coach, Johnny Mason.
What they actually need, Jim, they're at the 42 or 43-yard line. They've got to get the ball at least to the 38-yard line of Georgia Tech. So they need, but almost 20 yards.
From the 42-yard line, it is second down, but more important is the clock in the picture. 22 seconds. Throws, and that ball is caught across the way, and that is Swanson who caught the ball, and they may have a shot at a 50-yard field goal to tie the game up.
Here they come.
They don't have to rush it so far because they haven't moved the sticks yet. They can be ready. 51 yards out, Rebay's missed from 21, but hit from 55. He can tie the game with 14 seconds to go. Clock is running 10-9 from 51 yards out. There's a lot of leg. Does he get there? He does! Tied in! Oh, is this pathetic? Two great defenses, and they come down to a flat-out tie. That is Mark Pike. Defensive man thought his team had won the game, but from 51 yards out, Reveille has tied the game with 4 seconds to go.
Get Reveille. Watch the leg power. Watch the shot here. He just puts everything he has into it. He knows he's got it straight enough. He just wanted over was far enough. Just another day. Just another kick.
I tell you what. It isn't often you get a chance to come back under these circumstances after missing a 21-yarder. That would have tied the game, and that would have tied the game with 4:18 left, and with 14 seconds left, go ahead and kick one to tie the game. And he has done so, which, if they